Hey, thanks for joining us today. We're glad you're here. This series is gonna be amazing. We're gonna be listening in on conversations with people who work in the pro-life community every day. And as you're watching, we'll be answering questions like, when does life begin? How do I respond to unexpected pregnancies? And how do I get involved to take that step to help save lives? So come on, they have a lot to say. Let's listen in.
You're here for a reason.
Yes.
So when you look at life and that big question, I mean, okay, when does life begin?
As a doctor and as a scientist, life can only come from life. So for me, as I think about the beauty of life, there's no question.
Yeah.
You have to go through that phase of two living cells that unite to become one unique life.
Let me bounce this off of you because it's so interesting. I was with Senator James Lankford from Oklahoma. He's a great pro-life senator. Mm-hmm. And he said to me, he said, you know, Jim, think of the Mars mission where this lander is looking for evidence of life. If they were to scoop up this dirt and found the first moment of conception, the product of that fertilization, the cells dividing, you'd see on the front page of the New York Times, scientists proclaim life found on Mars. Mm-hmm. But for some reason, it's not true on Earth. Mm-hmm. Why is that?
It's not really a matter of when life begins. It's a matter of when does new life begin. You had a living sperm from the dad that gets together with a living egg from the mom, and they create a new life. Life begets life. And there's no doubt, scientifically, embryologically, from an obstetric standpoint, life, new life, begins at that moment of conception. And it's very complex. It starts off at the moment of conception. We have 300 million cells from the dad that are in a swim race. And they all start swimming with the goal of meeting an egg. They go in through the uterus, then they get to the egg. Now it's a competition on seeing who's going to get inside of the egg. And as soon as that first one gets on the inside, there's lots of chemical reactions that happen. It's at that moment that if you look with the right conditions and with the right frequency of light, you can see a flash of light. So people say, well, when does new life begin? It's like, there's a flash of light. I mean, what more do you want? Then there's a flash of light that says, this is not just life, this is new life. All of the cells, all of the genetics that are gonna come from this pregnancy are different from the mom, different from the dad, they're different from the other 7 billion people on the planet. Now it's a matter of we have the blueprints, we have the DNA, we're just one cell, now we have to start dividing. One cell, 2, 4, 8, 16, 32, keep changing until you and I sit here at about 60 trillion cells each. There's a miracle called cell differentiation. And what's that? That first cell, combination of 23 chromosomes from mom and 23 chromosomes from dad, is unique. And that's really the miracle of conception, where it's not just life, it is new life. Life that is unique from mom, life that is unique from dad, it's just a miracle.
As many deliveries that I've been at, it's just a remarkable thing. And when I even think about development in the uterus, as a baby is developing, by 11 weeks of life, everything is fully formed and it's just continuing to develop and grab more function. And to me, like, the heart starts beating at 3 to 4 weeks.
Yeah, it's beautiful.
That's an interesting point that when I talk to people about abortion, I don't think a lot of people realize is that every single one of these abortions ends a beating heart. Mm-hmm. And that the abortionist is only successful if a heart stops beating.
And the science is so persuasive. You know, when I've had so many conversations with friends, and we'll start off the different, you know, common arguments in favor of abortion, and it always ends up being steered towards this question in the end. Mm-hmm. Okay, when does life begin? And I think that's one of the reasons why, you know, in the media, and I'm sure you experience this so much, of this, like, smoke screen around, mm-hmm. the, you know, hear products of conception or can't even say heartbeat. And I think it's because it's so persuasive. One of my favorite stories about this is Dr. Bernard Nathanson. I've been familiar with him. He was one of the co-founders of NARAL Pro-Choice America, and at one point had the largest abortion facility in the country. And so for him, it was the development of ultrasound technology that eventually convinced him. He was seeing earlier and earlier stages. And so as a scientist, as a doctor, he had to conclude that life began at fertilization and became pro-life, spent the rest of his life advocating for the unborn, spoke at the March for Life, you know, really dedicated his life to this. So the science is so persuasive when we can share the truth, you know, about what it is.
Yeah.
And what I was going to say is I think the thing is people just don't know. Like, people don't know that a heart starts at 3 to 4 weeks because there's been so much propaganda, because they use other terms. Just the average person, like, we know, but like the average person does not know. And that's why like education is so important, and like us saying things, standing up and like telling people.
There's so much good work that's being done to educate people our age and younger about what is life, but also like from the scientific perspective, but then the beauty and the inherent dignity of human life, you know? And I think we're seeing the fruits of so many years and of work. It's incredibly encouraging. And I think that's also what brings people to the March for Life every year, because it's hard to be in a culture that doesn't agree with us. It can be very exhausting. Part of our hope is that with the March for Life, when we bring everyone together, you get refueled, inspired, you get to see, okay, this is what I'm doing this for, and it's a beautiful thing. All right, now let's go back out and do the unique thing that we're called to do.
I think a lot of times when you hear the argument about, well, we don't know when life begins, or I you know, I'm pro-choice because no one's sure, and you'll hear the debate of, well, it's not human, but it has to be human, right? The law of biogenesis says I can't, you know, reproduce a koala bear as much as I want one with my husband. I can only make a human being. And so it is absolutely human. We know it's distinct from the mother because the child has unique DNA code that's never existed before. It's self-directed. The mother's body doesn't tell the child how to develop. The child tells itself how it's going to develop. It's whole. It has everything it needs to survive and to grow.
And I think part of this battle, what we're talking about, is knowing what is plainly in front of you, that this is a baby, this is life. All it needs is time to grow, right? And it is human. And why has the culture gotten behind this idea that it's not a baby, it's a clump of tissue? I mean, it goes against logic.
It's convenient. I mean, if you just ignore, you know, the facts, the science, the truth, and it's just a clump of cells, it's no different than a polyp, then it's easy to get rid of, and it's easy to just kind of just put it in a little box and never think about it again. And it's really sad that they see the preborn as just a clump of cells, and that's something to just dispose of, even if it means, you know, like, you're going to be successful. You can't have this child because that's going to hinder you from that success.
I know for me, I had an unexpected pregnancy, and I grew up knowing abortion was wrong. My whole family, we were all a very pro-life family. But fear makes you do crazy things. And so when the world is saying it's a clump of cells, even though you know good and well it's not, it all of a sudden, like, it's like, it's easy to accept it all of a sudden. And, you know, I didn't end up going through with the abortion, but it got super close. I ended up hyperventilating and passing out in the abortion room after I'd already paid for it and everything. And I'm so thankful that my body, like, took over my will. And, you know, and I have a son now.
I remember, you know, taking those pregnancy tests. One time I even pretended I didn't see the result. But I just remember feeling so ashamed and so just dirty, because I knew that my parents would be so heartbroken. And so I was scared. I didn't know, you know, how I was gonna tell them. I ended up telling my mom a week after, and of course she was sad, devastated. With my dad, we told him later on. That was probably the hardest, I think, is telling my father. Whenever I think of my dad, I think of the story of the prodigal son, because my dad just, we didn't talk for a week after, but he said, you know, it's okay. We're gonna do this. You know, we support you. We want you to finish school. We're gonna help you with whatever you need. And and
that's
welcomed
great.
Me in open arms. And like, our relationship, the relationship with both of my parents, is just stronger than ever. And it's amazing how God used, you know, the brokenness of that situation for something beautiful.
There needs to be a level of honor, a level of love, like your parents showed you, of not just respecting the unborn life, but loving on that woman regardless of the situation that brought them to that, and caring for them. When you show that kind of compassion for the mom and still want to stay involved when that mom makes that choice, that hard choice to stay involved in that child's life, I say to people, it's much harder to be a pro-life supporter than a pro-choice supporter. When we're saying we honor you and that baby, the responsibility's on us not just to care for that mom and that baby in the womb, but afterward.
I have a couple friends who, you know, they were in the same situation I was in, and the look on their faces when I tell them, you know, you can do this, you know, you're doing something so great, and, you know, there's resources, there's a support group at my school for parenting students. Like, it just turns from this face of, oh my gosh, I'm so alone, to, oh, there's hope, and I really can do this, so.
Right.
And,
or saying congratulations instead of I'm sorry.
Always.
That's huge. Like, you can do this.
Yeah. The role of the church is to defend life and discuss forgiveness. Sometimes, that when it comes to the subject of pregnancy, we look at that differently than other sins. Pregnancy, maybe even out of wedlock. I mean, don't shame those people. I mean, celebrate this life. They might have made a choice that wasn't in God's plan as far as having sex before marriage. Okay, it happens. We're all sinners. But what did they do once they found out that decision? Did they go and have an abortion, or are they going to recognize that this is a gift created in the image of God, and we're going to celebrate that? The church needs to embrace that, and they need to take them in and love them. We're going to celebrate this new life created in the image of God. We're going to provide you with the support, and we're going to celebrate this baby's delivery.
Sometimes people are in situations where their family isn't going to come alongside them, you know, and they're like genuinely like, okay, I have no resources. What am I supposed to do? And that's where, as you said, like the pro-life movement, it's a harder thing to do because it's a call to action. Are you looking at the people just in your community to say, how can I love you and what support do you need? And to recognize that it's each of us individually have a part to play in this. Really looking, taking an account of like, okay, what has God given me? Genuinely owning that, and then how can I use that to love?
Yeah.
And it's amazing the doors that get open as a result.
Yeah. When I did my book, we interviewed a bunch of young women, and the difference we found with every single woman we interviewed was the woman who had someone who immediately came alongside and said, congratulations, you can do this, chose life. Whether she placed with an adoptive family or she parented. Like, it's so easy to be pro-life because you just be that one person. Just be that person, always positively.
Students for Life, I mean, you guys are kind of the point of the spear, because you're on these campuses, not Christian campuses, maybe some, but you're on these campuses where you have an adversarial perspective.
Actually, sometimes the big schools are easier than the Christian schools.
Sometimes they don't think it's necessary.
Like,
sometimes
it's not necessary here. No one here is having sex, Jen.
Yeah.
It's not necessary. I'm like, well, half of all women who have abortions are Christian. Mm-hmm. Or
say that again so people catch it. I mean, that's stunning.
Yeah. Half of all women who have an abortion self-identify as a Christian and said that they've gone to church regularly.
And again, that's a wake up to do all the things we talked about earlier, to embrace them, help them. It's not guilt. It's like, wow, what can I do for the 20-something, the 30-something, the young mom? Yeah. I mean, and she believes in life. You know, what can she do to do a little more to promote the idea that a baby's a baby?
I think that's the easiest way to get involved with social media now is just start following Students for Life, March for Life, Live Action, and start watching the videos. You'll start like absorbing the information. Mm-hmm. So when it comes up in a conversation at your church, you'll be like, oh, you'll amaze yourself sometimes.
I do frequently.
I'm just like, well, how'd that happen?
Having conversations with your friends, you don't have to be confrontational. Like, some people like that. Some people like to be on the social media and, like, go back and forth. But, like, just a regular conversation with your friends, I think, goes a long way. Mm-hmm. Because a lot of your friends probably are getting the same information you're getting and they don't know. Mm-hmm. So if you can just have conversations like with your immediate people, I think that'll go a long way too, because your friends don't know that you're pro-life unless you tell them, because right now the default is pro-choice.
The beauty of, as we talk and all that we're doing, that it's a very expansive issue. It's not just being against something, it is is loving. It's showing humanity who Christ is, and loving those moms who've been marginalized and things like that.
At the March for Life, we put it into kind of three different words: unite, educate, mobilize. So first, unite. Who are your people? You know, finding those other pro-life friends, and then educate. Watch these videos. You know, we have some just right here. There's so many different resources that you all have created, and so that education piece, and then mobilize is the last one.
I think one of the biggest things is to meet other people who are being bold, who are standing up. And I think once you do that, you'll also feel a little bit more encouraged too. So I think once you like kind of take responsibility and you surround yourself with other people who are similar to you in that regard, you can become bolder.
I was thinking in the same vein is that I think the challenge to us as Christians, it's really the ball's in our court. Yeah. It is not in the pro-choice court. And what it is that not only that we have to talk the talk, we have to walk the walk. Mm-hmm. And I think there has been a misconception that perhaps we as Christians haven't been good at walking the walk. Yeah. We can talk the talk, but we got to be willing to walk the walk.
Yeah, that's exactly what I was going to say, that sometimes maybe someone is like more introvert and they just have, you know, a harder time having conversations. Well, let your actions be the change you want to see in the world. Go serve at a pregnancy center.
Go serve at a maternity home.
For like 40 days for life.
Let your actions.
Yeah.
40 days for life.
Serving at a maternity home could be mowing the lawn.
Sure. Oh,
yeah. We have more than like 2,500 pregnancy centers and maternity homes across the country who, if you walk in the door, will literally do anything they can to make sure she feels supported throughout the pregnancy and then after the birth of her child. Be a marketer for the pro-life movement. Be like, hey, did you know there's all these pregnancy centers and maternity homes? Here's a, you know, Heartbeat International's phone number, optionline.org, standingwithyou.com. Like, there's all these places. But I think that's something that we all as Christians should just be a marketer and have a, like a little resource.
Mm-hmm. And if you see someone in your church that's like young and pregnant and like you can be the person to talk, like you don't even have to say be pro-life. You can just say, hey, you know what? I saw that. I got you this. Or hey, you want me to come over? I can mow your lawn. I can clean your...
Or just speak life to her.
Yeah.
And like give her some encouragement.
Just reaffirming that life is beautiful.
Exactly.
And that, you
know,
like children are a blessing. And anytime, you know, you see a young mom, if you have the chance to sell it, hey, you're doing a great job. Like, I'm so proud of you.
And that's walking the walk and talking the talk.
Let's move with compassion and let love speak. Let's move with compassion and let love speak.
Wow, that was amazing. Compassion and grace, love, that flash of light when conception happens. Oh, God is making a statement. And what a great conversation. We can help others choose life. We can love them well and support them. What can you do? Well, here's an easy first step. Focusonthefamily.com/seelife. Oh, and don't miss next week's episode. We're gonna be talking to everyday heroes that work in the pregnancy resource centers. It's gonna be epic. And I hope to see you in Dallas.